Hello and welcome back to our third video on the Desmos musical graph for the Collatz conjecture. So something I wanted to look at in the future videos was obviously using Desmos to make the music, but one of the things I was going to do before that I came across and I found quite interesting was using other features of our graph, which we didn't get to finish last time. Last time we came up with using the proportion as a number. So we have a proportion number. So let's say we put our n selected as 33. We have a proportion number of 3.030. And basically what the proportion number does is it takes the largest number reached, which is in this case 100, and it divides it by the number you start with, so 33. So that's how we get the 3.03. But what's interesting is the way that the numbers are scattered across. For example, numbers that are powers of 2, such as 8, will always have a proportion number of 1, because 8 will always divide by 2, so it will always decrease, and the highest number reached will always be itself. Therefore, the proportion number, which is itself divided by the highest number reached, will be 8. So there's no worries with that particularly. I want to try and add some things to what we've already done. And first, what I'm going to do is I'm going to close this. I'm going to add a new tab, and we're going to call it the stats tab, just because everything's getting quite crowded and I want to add a lot more stats here. I'm just going to add a folder. Stats. We've already got a few stats, and I'm going to move them here. So these are all display stuff, that's fine. The steps, that's a statistics, so we'll move that out. This is part of the display of the statistics, we can move that out, we'll move this out. The max as well, these points should probably come outside as well. This point, yeah, that's for the number of iterations. So this stuff is still just for display. I guess we could take X max out as well, but no, that's actually just putting a point up here, so that's fine. But apart from that, we can actually just finish with the visuals now and close that. We can close the numbers as well. That's done. So what we want to do is really look at the program and see what else we can define, because we have a proportion number. But what you'll notice is that the proportion number will vary highly based on which number you pick. For example, if I pick, let's say, 27, which is one of our weird numbers, the proportion number shoots up incredibly high to something like 341. It's huge, right? But if you have something like 12, the proportion number is quite low, but the number of iterations isn't much higher anyways. So what I noticed is that we should probably try and make some sort of relation between the proportion number and number of iterations. And the first thing I'm going to do that is create a new statistic. We're going to call it BHATT, named after my last name. But let's just move this first. And we'll add a new term down here. So everything that we do here, I've kind of got a hang of this program now. We basically have to subscript and then make it equivalent to something. In this case, let's do 10 multiplied by our S max. Divided by n input, which is our proportion number, basically. What we had for when we made our proportion number. But we want to divide the whole thing by our number of iterations, so S length. And it's quite interesting what we get after doing that, because before we had a weird number for all our values. So now our proportion number is 1.33. But our bat number is also 1.33 because the S length is 10 and we multiplied by 10. But let's say if we change it to that weird number we were talking about earlier, 27, our proportion number is 341, but our bat number is only 30. So that's really reduced it. I think it's kind of bringing everything into perspective. For example, 17, our proportion number is 3 and our bat number is 2. For a different number, let's say 81, proportion numbers 3, bat numbers 1.3. So it's kind of honing in on a value. We also want to present this on the graph, so we can do something like this. We can add a point, and that point's going to be 0.7, and I think we make it minus 0.15. That's a good place to keep it, and we should make it blue. remove the point, we'll need to label it. We'll call this the bat constant because I am very ego. That's not a word, but you know what I mean. So the bat constant, and we're going to do the same thing in the program. We've got dollar, the curly brackets, and now it's a really interesting part. We can put this in underscore and bat, and we have our bat constant on our screen. So that's amazing because we did that in just a few seconds. They're just joining a little bit too much together there, so what I'm going to do is zoom out a bit. There you go. That's a bit better. Yeah, so that's our bat constant. We want to add some other stuff though, because we have basically our maximum value, highest number reached, the steps taken, the proportion number, and now the bat value. And we have them all labeled here as well. So I think realistically, those are the statistics we need for now, and that's done. So from this video, we just basically made something new, like a constant that we might be able to use. So the bat constant is just trying to keep the variance between all these numbers similar. For example, n selected, if it's, let's say, 79, you're getting something like 2. And if you're getting the weird numbers like 27, it's still going to be like much more, it's going to be much larger, 30, but it's still not going to be too far out. So that's the great part. Something I've realized when doing this and making the bat constant is that for numbers such as 27, when we get a huge bat constant like 30, there's also a really, 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 really large number of peaks, right? And I know we've done iterations, but you can get numbers like, I don't know, like 1024, which have like a decent number of iterations, but not a single peak. So it's not just the iteration, it's also about the number of peaks and troughs. So that's what I'm going to do next. I'm going to basically try and count the number of peaks and troughs. And that might be difficult because we don't actually know what the peaks and troughs are for each graph. So this might take some time and some reasoning. I basically spent about 2 hours doing this the other day, so I'm going to try this from memory. But what I think we should do is make a new section entirely. So let's just put all of this in the stats section. So we can just get rid of it now because we don't need any of this stuff anymore. The proportion and steps. So the great thing about Desmos is, you know, it's not got a language, but it's also not got any limits, really. You can do pretty much whatever you want with the program, and it's working pretty well so far. And again, the accessibility feature we're going to use at some point for the music paper. So now that you've done that, we'll just close this, and we'll make a new folder. We'll call the folder, call it Peaks and Troughs. Right. Now for the peaks and troughs, we're going to basically want to make another ticker, probably. That's what I'm thinking. So we'll make another four variables. Make O, and we'll try and make a condition. Because what actually is a peak? I mean, if we look at this graph here, that's a peak there, isn't it? Yeah. And we can consider this here a trough. So if a peak is basically where n next is larger than n last, let's try and make a condition using that. So O can be the ticker that we're going to use. We really want to make a condition, and that's going to be probably P. So P equals, and then we need curly brackets to make an if statement. We're going to say that if N next is larger than, capitalize N because everything in Desmos is case sensitive, is larger than N last. And we also need to say it's larger than 1, otherwise I think you will just keep beating forever. If n next is larger than n last is larger than n1, and then we use the semicolon for the then, I think what we should do is we should do the same thing we did with the other graph, where we basically have a set and we join items to set, and then we can count the numbers in the set by doing like whatever the set is length. So I think what we're going to do is j action into j joining. So we're going to have j.join. Again, everything is case sensitive. It's quite annoying. I'm going to put an n last because that's the number that basically signifies that the that there's like a peak. So because if n last is larger than n, I mean, if n next is larger than n last, then we've basically gone up, so it's a peak. Something we discussed in the previous video is in the Collatz conjecture, when you apply the 3n plus 1 rule, you always get an even. So if you get a peak, basically, it means you have to go down like straight after. So you can't get multiple peaks. I mean, you can get multiple peaks, but you can't get multiple iterations in one peak. So we'll call this n last. And then we're done with that. So we're going to want to make a set as well, aren't we? We're going to make the j set we just talked about. All we need to do for that is just make a square bracket set. And then we're going to do the same sort of thing we did before. We're going to have another element, and we're going to call it y, so that y equals another condition, and that condition has to be basically we want when this happens, we want j to join this set here. But the issue is, I don't think that's going to like reset every time that happens. So we can try it. I'm not actually sure what we're going to do with that, but let's try making the ticker function. In our previous example, the ticker function was quite simple, really. We had g n selected equals n input, then apply c, if not apply r. So I see, okay, so if n selected equals n input, right, so n selected will always equal n input, so that you'll always apply c, right? So otherwise r, which is this one here, but we also have r is n input goes n selected anyways, and n selected joins s. Right, so whenever we have n selected equal n input, as in when we change this, right, that's when we get the r condition. That's why that resets. So I think we're going to need to make the y so it resets. Otherwise, we'll just get a list, and I'll show you what I mean by not doing y. We'll just do o, and that'll be n last. I think we should do equals maybe to me. N last equals n selected. Yes. Then apply y. Otherwise, apply p. Because when n last effect equals n selected, it means that it's the start of a new set of iterations. And that's basically what we want. Thing is, we haven't defined y yet. So what happens if we just forget that and put p here, if not p? We run our program. Try 15, I mean 32. Nothing happens to our set. That's quite annoying, actually. We try again, maybe. 49. Yeah, so our set's filled up with 7, right? There is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. There's 7 peaks, so that's good. But if we try it again, yeah, that's 13, but I don't think there's 13 peaks here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So what it's done is it's adding them, it's not resetting them. So what we want to do is this is the reason we have the y condition. So here we had the r condition because we wanted it to reset. It took me a really long time to actually figure out that we need another condition like that here because I kept doing it and this list kept going infinitely larger. If we remove this one, for example, that just infinitely fills up, and that's not what we want. So we'll have the one there. And then we're going to have to put a y condition quite similar to our r1. So what we're going to need to do for that is probably we could technically, I think we just need to make a condition, don't we? N selected. N selected is less than n next. Oh, I see. So basically, I think what we should. Oh, I see. So basically, if n next is bigger than n selected, basically in this case, what that means is the next number, if it's bigger than our n selected, which is this number here, in this case it's 74, n next isn't bigger, so we're applying the tertiary condition. But if it is bigger, then what we're doing is j basically is gonna tend to n selected. Otherwise, so that's a comma. Otherwise, we're going to have J tend to nothing because we don't want anything. Just an empty thing. Right. And the way this works is basically All you want to do is we want to empty this. So if n selected, as in the number we select is less than n next, then j tends to n selected. So I say tends to because I'm so used to that. It's just an action. So that j will just become n selected. And we want to make this part of our ticker. I don't understand the... Oh, I see. I haven't put a semicolon. I put a colon. Yes, I see now. Now this should work because if we change that to 28, oh no, it's not worked. It's got even more peaks now. So something's clearly wrong because it's not resetting it. I think we may have made a mistake. So we have our ticker, and the ticker says that if n last equals n selected, then we apply y. Otherwise, we apply p. So, actually, I think we're doing the wrong thing. Because that doesn't make sense. Thinking what else we could do. Yeah, this is quite interesting, actually. Because this is just for the peaks and troughs. This is probably going to take a long time to think about, really. So we have the fact that if n selected is less than n next, then we do this, or we do that. Trying to think what I've done wrong. Because this should be working, but it's not. Let's try a different number, maybe. Let's try 58. Oh, I'm being so stupid. I just realized that we got the O right there, yeah, but we haven't actually put it in the ticker. Right, now that we've started the ticker up here, it should work. So let's say we run the ticker. Now we've got 20, 45, 66. Right, let's just check our elements list. J, yes, we have 8 elements, which basically means, yeah, we have the right number. So everything seems to be working fine. And that's exactly what we want, really. So... there's 8 peaks, so let's just check, just be sure if there is 8 peaks. There's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Right, that makes a lot more sense. Yeah, so just going over what we did quickly, O equals, basically, we have the same sort of thing we had in our number section, where we had 4 different things, and we have a ticker function. So O is our ticker function, and the ticker function states that if n last equals n selected, basically... if we're basically choosing n selected, as in if we've started a different number. So if we choose a different number that's not 66, our n last will become 66, or like whatever the new number is. So then we'll run y, and what y does is basically it's saying that if n selected is less than n next, as in, let's say 66 isn't a good example for that. Yeah, 55, that's less than n next, right? So if that's the case, then we add n selected to our j, because what we want is, in our J set, we want all the maximums. And this maximum here won't be counted because of our condition that n last equals n selected, apply y, otherwise p. Because if n last doesn't equal n selected, we apply p. And in p, if n next is bigger than n last, bigger than n1, we have n last join J. But that only works when n last doesn't equal n selected, right? So we don't get this first peak. So to get that first peak in y, we need to have another condition, and that's if n selected is less than n next, as in whatever we have here, then we have that n selected 55 will join this set, and that has worked out here. Otherwise, let's say we have, for example, 66 or something, like previously we had 66. Yeah, we don't have 66 joining because, oh, whole thing disappeared. Let's just get rid of that. Yeah. Let's say we have something like 66. We don't have anything joining because in 66, zoomed out incredibly. Yeah, in 66, we're basically going down. So there's not a maximum there, so we don't need to include it. So that's why that exists. I don't know how to simplify that, really, because basically what we're saying is that if n last equals n selected, so when we restart, we want to basically refresh our set, otherwise we get that infinite set which keeps adding on elements instead of giving us what we really want. So now that we have that done, if we didn't have the y condition here, that j, basically you add n selected to j, otherwise j goes to blank, we wouldn't get the right number of peaks. For example, if I remove this condition here, right, and I just make it j goes to thing like this, j goes to an empty set, and we make it caps on j because that's what we're dealing with. It would work because each time we're going to a new set, right? But here's the issue. If you have something like this where you have a peak up here, we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 peaks here, but this is only counting seven elements, seven peaks. And that's wrong because it's not counting the first peak, because the first peak is disregarded because n last equals n selected when you get 33. And so you apply y, so you go straight to zero. So the first one isn't counted. So that's why we had that condition. And that condition is basically very useful. It took me a really long time to get that, but that's like the problem solving. That's the beauty of maths, I guess. So yeah, fun. So now we kind of want to display that, but before we do that, we also want to kind of work out probably the because we have the peaks, we kind of want to work out the other stuff. So peaks are basically when the 3n plus 1 is applied, because that's when we're going up, and we only go up when 3n plus 1 is applied. In the previous videos, we kind of discussed how if it goes up, it can only go up once. It can't go up like up and then up again, because when you apply 3n plus 1, you get an even number, so it has to divide by 2. So the peaks will be like individuals. So every peak, so the number of peaks there are is basically the number of times you apply the 3n plus 1, and the number of dips, as in these parts here, is the number of applies we divide by 2. So I want to calculate the number of dips, and basically that shouldn't be too hard to do. We'll just call that dips, and we'll say that that equals s length, which is the number of iterations we have, and we'll say that it equals that minus j length, which is the number of peaks we have. In this case, that's 20, right? And I don't know if that's right, so we'll just check. That's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19. So there's 19, not 20, so we'll just add or subtract 1, because I think that it doesn't count this. It basically just adds another one. We don't want another one. So yes, because the thing is, our iterations counts this one as an iteration. It counts 66, like when we've done nothing, as an iteration. So we should probably subtract one from that as well, but I'm not sure how much that'll help. But we'll disregard that for now. Actually, no, we'll fix that now while we're at it. So our statistics, let's just check if that's true. So for 4, we divide by 2 and we divide by 2 again to get to 1. That should be 2 iterations. Yeah, it says 3, so let's just subtract 1 from our iterations. I need to find where our iterations thing was. Yeah, that's the length of our thing. Number of iterations is steps, but now that's just missing somewhere. Probably be in numbers. No, it's not, it's just gone. Statistics, bat constant, proportion number, the maximum number. Maybe it's in our peaks and troughs. Oh, that's weird. The number of iterations has just disappeared. No, never mind. It's here. Steps. But where's the definition of it? It's not here. It's just gone. How's it even counting? Doesn't make much sense, to be honest. Just turn that off and turn it back on. It should be in there. Trying to look for the steps, but I can't find it. That's weird. That's very weird, actually. Let me just quickly add steps, because it just seems to be missing. There you go. So we have our steps thing there. And yeah, so that's, we need to subtract 1. So our steps is 2. and our label is going to become that capital. Yeah, so now our number of iterations is fixed as well. So that's two iterations, and the proportion number will also adjust accordingly, because we have two iterations, the highest number achieved is 4. So the proportion number is still 1, but the number of iterations is 2. We might make another number where we basically look at the number reached based on iterations, but that is quite basically what we're doing with proportion number. We're saying number reached based on the number we selected over the number of iterations. So that in this case would be 1 over 2. So the back constant should be 1 over 2 divided by our s length. The back constant was here, wasn't it? It's, yeah, s max over n inputs of the proportion divided by the iteration. So if we go back to 4, if we reapply the ticker, yeah, it should be 3.33333. Because it's also multiplied by 10. It's 10 multiplied by a third, which is that. So yeah, because we have 1/2 divided by 2. Yeah. S max is our highest number reached. Our n input in this case was 4. So highest number 4 over 4 is 1. 1 divided by s length, which is the length of the set. Yeah, but that's... Oh, I see, that's wrong, so that should be s length minus 1. Right, so that makes a back constant 5. Yeah, so that fixes things. Yes, good. It's really good that you find bugs like this, otherwise the whole program's kind of, you know, wasted. Let's just make sure there's nothing else like that anywhere else. We could have just put steps underneath there, I guess. But, you know, that just seemed like a waste of time when I initially did it. So that's fine. We'll add dips to this bit here. So we have our troughs, we have our dips, we have our peaks. We want to define the peaks as well so we can kind of write it on the graph. We have that peaks basically equals our element list j. So we just say that j length, as in how many elements we have in our list j. So in this case, that's 0 peaks, and that's correct. So that's correct. We have dips, peaks, and we want to have troughs. So let's pick a different number. Let's pick 41. You know how we have peaks? We also have troughs, and that's when we reach an odd number. And whenever we reach an odd number, we have to apply the 3n plus 1. So realistically, the number of troughs should basically be equal to the number of peaks. But that you obviously have a case where that's not true. For example, when you start and you go down straight away like this, as in when you start with an even number, then you have a trough instantly. But if you start with a odd number like 17, then you're going to go up like instantly. You're not going to have a trough to start off with. So that needs to be accounted for, and we'll make another condition for that. We'll call this troughs. When I first wrote this, it took a lot of time to actually think over, but I decided to use the same modulo argument that we did last time. So we use mod, and we have n selected, and we have comma 2, not in the base, obviously we need to change that position. We have that equals 0. If that equals 0, then we need to put then we say that it's j length, as in the length of j. Otherwise, it's j length probably plus 1, I think. Plus 1. Not exactly sure. It's plus 1. I think it should be the other way around, shouldn't it? If it's even, it'll be plus 1. Yeah, it will be, yeah. And the reason for that is we'll just look at it graphically speaking, because in this now it says 3, right? We have 1, 2, 3. We'll always count this bit here as a trough for these examples anyways. It's basically a trough is when we apply the 3n plus 1, apart from here, because at 1 we will apply 3n plus 1 and get to 4. So that's how we're going to count our troughs. I'm not sure exactly whether we should count our bit here as a trough or not. if we decide not to, we just need to add a minus one. So this would be j length minus one. I mean, yeah, j length or j length minus one. The reason we're saying if it's even, we have to count extra is because, for example, here, if it's odd, we have 1, 2, 3 peaks and we have 1, 2, 3 troughs. But if it's even, then we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 peaks and 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 troughs. But we also have this one here, right? So it's just an additional one for the even numbers. And that's because we go down and then we start our peaks. We don't have a, we don't count this as a peak, and that's the only reason why, you know, we have that condition. So now we have the troughs, we'll add that here as well. So what we're going to do now is we're going to create another constant, and that's going to be proportional constant. We'll call this one the Dvarkar constant, just because that'll be a good one to call it. And I know it sounds really egocentric, me calling this stuff names and stuff, but it's just, you know, it's just for fun, I guess. We have that, that's my constant, divided by troughs. And the reason I'm doing that is because if we look at the bat number, the bat constant, yeah, whenever we have a large bat constant, so if we try 100, for example, we have 0.4. If we try 27, we have a large bat constant. We also have a ridiculously large number of troughs and peaks, and because they're basically the same, I think I'm going to decide to use troughs, because we can always have troughs, right? Because we always count the 41 bit as a trough, but we don't always have peaks, and we can't have something divided by zero, so we'll count this as a trough, right? And then we'll also have more plus on the dips, because number of dips is basically kind of larger in numbers, where this Dvarkar constant here, if we just have that as 0.75, and then we choose, I don't know, 54, our Dvarkar constant is like 0.363, but if we choose 100, it's 0.05, it's very small. But then you also notice that in 100, you know, the number of dips you have is also like generally larger in terms of a proportion than the number of like troughs. So you apply the divide by 2 more times than you apply the 3n plus 1, and you know, you can generally expect that, but we can try an experiment. We can add d ips over, you know, 100, just to equalize these constants, and then yeah, we'll multiply it by, you know, 10. That seems too large. Leave it like that for now. But that's one constant extra. I think we'll make another one as well, because I was really interested in the proportion of dips to actual troughs. Not dips to troughs, sorry. Dips to peaks, because the number of dips we have, the number of peaks we have are going to be in a way like proportionate, in the sense that they are the rules of the collapse conjecture. If there's a peak, it means we've applied the 3n plus 1. If there's a dip, it means we've applied the divide by 2. So if we find like how many there are, it becomes useful. So if we call that one the Ulam, just because, you know, this is also known as the Ulam conjecture. And basically, we can start applying this, I guess. We can multiply the Dvarkar constant by the Ulam, and we can get something like this. We multiply by Ulam, we get 0.12. So it seems very confusing what I'm doing right now, but the reason I did this, so I'm just redoing what I did earlier. I'm just kind of making something up. I'm trying to make this into an algorithm. So with the stuff I found here, you know, if we choose any number, let's say we choose 27, one of our weird numbers, yeah, we get an Ulam number of 0.58 and a Dvarkar number of 1.61, which is pretty standard, because let's say we pick, I don't know, something random, 52, and we look at our Dvarkar number 0.32. It says it's like between 1 and 2, I mean like 0 and 2, and it's not small, it's all within like 10 digits, not 10 digits, like it's in the tens digits and the units digits. So it's working out pretty well, I think. So the next thing I'm going to do is I'm going to represent this new data that we have on the graph here. The issue with these videos is I'm not actually able to show you how much pain and stress went into making this, because I spent literally 6, 7 hours trying to make each of these, and I haven't fully explained the Dvaka constant yet, and I will do that in a future video. And what I'm doing now is I'm just showing you how I did it, but this stuff literally took me ages. I was sat there pining, thinking, just walking around. I would leave, go outside in the garden, look at the trees, and then come back inside. I'd be like, oh no, I haven't found anything. And then eventually I'd think of something new until I'd find something. And I'm not even sure what it's called in maths, where you try and basically take something that's so random, like the Collatz conjecture. We have so many weird peaks and stuff, and it basically gives you something kind of regular. For example, if we stop being in the hundreds, we pick something ridiculously large like that, right? It's going to take a really, really long time to iterate. But the bat constant is going to be like very small. Like you can clearly see that as it's getting larger, it's becoming smaller. But the Dvaka constant is just 1.2. And that's crazy because it's so similar to something like 16 or 80. It's just being constrained. So I think there is a relation and we can use this to find it. And it's just incredible. So what we're going to do now is we're going to basically put these on the thing by basically making some points. We'll just use some random coordinates and try and figure out where to put them. 0.023. Think we'll put one at 0.25 and negative 0.23. The whole point of representing it on the graph is so that we can do an analysis using several digits of data. I'm gonna make a time lapse where I do several like points of data, so let's say like 1 to 1,000, where we look at all the statistics that we have, and then we basically analyze that stuff later on in the paper. So we have 0.7, another one for the Dvaka constant or the Ulam constant, and we have minus 0.31 for that. We want these to be in a regular color because we don't want it to be too distracting. Thing is, I really want people to be able to use this in the future, maybe to do whatever they want to do with the Collatz conjecture, because it's a little fun thing that I found that is quite fun just to use. This doesn't have to be groundbreaking. Nothing ever has to be groundbreaking, but it can be fun. And I don't know, that's I guess the point of this conjecture. So we'll make those points white. We'll make the next ones orange, and we'll make the next ones white again. Just give it some contrast. And we'll just get rid of the points. And now we'll label these accordingly. So the first one we'll call the number of troughs. Don't even know if troughs is the right word. Maybe I should have called it ravines or something. But number of troughs. And we'll call that one. We have to do the dollar thing. The dollar thing basically assigns our subscript and the curly arrows. I think the dollar in regular programming, I'm not sure, I'm not really a computer scientist myself. I've never been interested that much in that kind of stuff. But I think the dollar basically signifies text. Maybe it's like display stuff like visuals and stuff that we did in the other section. So troughs, and number of troughs is 129, so that's all fixed there. And then we want on this one, we want number of peaks. Those two kind of correspond with each other. We might have them next to each other. Dollar, and we'll call that peaks. Yep, and that works as well. And you can see that they're very similar. And that's what we kind of wanted. And we want number of dips. I say number of dips, but realistically, what I'm saying is the number of times you divide by two in the conjecture. Same we did before. And we get the dips on there. And then we're going to put the Dvaka number. Think because of how small this bit was here, we can probably change that bit. But I think the Ulam bit and this bit kind of. There's a connection. The thing is, if you're able to find some sort of number, a constant, right? Then I think in a way that's a heuristic argument for the Collatz conjecture. And that is what I'm trying to do, a heuristic argument. And the more and more close you get to a constant, you can basically hypothesize about one. And that's what I'm going to do basically in the next few videos, possibly. I'm going to hypothesize about a constant. It'll be called the Dvorak constant. And I'm going to say that there exists something like a Dvorak constant. And what that does is basically it applies to every single number in the collapse conjecture. So if you know a few parts of data, like for example the number of troughs, or in this case the number of peaks or dips, then you'll be able to calculate any part of it. So that works pretty well, to be honest. We have all our data on here: the Ulam number, the number of dips, the Dvorak number, the troughs, the number of peaks, the proportion number, the Bat constant, obviously our original highest number reached, and our number of iterations. So in the next video, I might come up with another constant of proportion between, I think, the Ulam number and the number of dips, probably. And then we'll record that here as well. Otherwise, I think we've come up with all the statistics we really need for these graphs. And I think it's time to start using the data we found by experimenting with Desmos in order to actually do something with it. And you know what? It's been a great journey using Desmos because it's crazy because a few weeks ago I used to use this thing for working out, the roots of quartics or doing some hard math problems. I never thought we could do something like this because this is probably the hardest math problem there is, with people like Frederick Gauss even saying that math isn't right for this. And that man basically gave us the start to solving the Riemann hypothesis. And he says something, it's got to be right. So for our music paper, we're going to again use that accessibility feature. So go to numbers. Sorry, then we go to visuals, click on our graph, and click Alt T, and we can hear our graph. Obviously, because we have so many different points, it's going to sound terrible. Yeah, that's basically what I'm trying to say with that is, if you increase the number to be large enough, you're kind of going to get this same sort of trend because the larger you get, the more and more it just becomes regular. Like the larger the number gets, the more regular it seems, iterations. And I think the limit of this program is probably 10 to the 52 because after that it doesn't seem to calculate. And for 10 to 52, it takes ages. And as you can see, the Bat number is tiny, the Ulam number is about 0.33, but the Dvorak number is almost constant. It's 1.2, like a number. Let's choose a random number here. The Dvorak number starts to decrease, as you can see initially, but then because of the Ulam number, it starts to increase again, and it's going to reach something like about, like I don't know, between 0 and 2, 1.4, and this is a completely random number, and we're dealing with randomness between 0 and 1.098 times 10 to the 51. That's a huge range. It's ridiculously large. That's more than there are galaxies in the sky. That's more than sand on the ground in the earth. It's just incredible. That's almost a Google. That's like a square root of a Google. That's how many different things we're doing. And that's what's crazy about this entire thing. So I know it's been a long video. Thank you for sticking around. Next time, we're going to be probably finding one more constant, and then we're going to apply the musical aspect of this. What I'm going to try and do is, when I'm actually at the conference, I'm going to try and get a video of me at the conference. I'm going to try and get somebody to video me while I'm there, and then I'll be able to post that as well because it's an excellent opportunity. And the speech I've been preparing for it is mad, and I really hope it sounds great. So, thanks, and see you next time.
Lonely as a man.